Okay, this is breast part one, benign and pre-invasive disease, ABSITE and board review. It's a lot of information. Briefly, let's talk about high yield anatomy. The breast develops from ectoderm. You can have accessory nipples called polythelia along the milk line, which is usually below the breast on the upper abdomen. The Cooper's ligaments suspend the breast and are the reason breast abscesses are usually multiloculated and need surgical drainage to break up the multiple cavities. Cooper's ligaments also cause retraction of the skin when being pulled in during breast cancer. The milk is produced in lobules and travels to the nipple and ducts. There is a fat pad and fascia that separates the breast from the pectoralis muscle. The axilla is bordered by the lateral pectoralis edge, superiorly by the axillary vein, posteriorly by the subscapularis muscle, laterally by the anterior border of the latissimus, and inferiorly where the latissimus and the serratus meet. The pectoralis minor muscle is behind the pec major, and the medial pectoral nerve and artery are usually encountered just lateral to the pectoralis minor during surgery. The medial pectoral nerve is actually lateral to the lateral pectoral nerve, and the medial pectoral nerve supplies the pectoralis major and minor muscles and is easy to preserve during surgery, although there is usually a vascular branch coming lateral from the bundle that has to be divided during the axillary dissection. An ultrasound-guided regional block called the PEX block can anesthetize the pectoral nerves prior to breast and axillary surgery. The long thoracic nerve runs along the serratus medially, and damage causes winged scapula. The thoracodorsal nerve runs posterior to the axillary vein. It runs along the subscapularis muscle with its similarly named artery and vein and supplies the latissimus muscle, so damage causes weak pull-ups. The thoracodorsal artery is also the arterial supply for the latissimus flap, so if the patient is going to have a breast reconstruction via this method, be very careful with this bundle. The brachial plexus is intertwined with the axillary artery superior to the axillary vein, and you should not be that high during axillary dissection. The level 1 axillary nodes are lateral to the pec minor. Level 2 are behind the pec minor, and level 3 are medial to the pec minor. Rotter's nodes are between the pec major and minor and are considered part of level 2. The supraclavicular and internal mammary nodes are occasionally involved in breast cancer, but tend not to be surgically removed, but they do change stage and are usually radiated. Batson plexus is a network of venous drainage from the breast that is thought to be a route of direct metastasis to the spine. Okay, let's talk about some high-yield benign breast problems. Pullen syndrome is amastia, which means there is no breast tissue, and usually has absence of the pectoralis muscle and has upper extremity deformities. Pullen syndrome is more common in men than women by 3-to-1. And is thought to be due to an interruption in the vascular supply to the chest and utero. Breast pain is called mastodynia or mastalgia. It's classified as either cyclic, meaning it's related to menstrual cycles and easier to treat, or non-cyclic, which is fairly continuous and harder to treat. It is a very difficult problem to treat, and the majority of breast surgeons spend their time reassuring patients that pain is almost never a symptom of breast cancer. The treatments start with behavior modifications, such as decreasing caffeine and warm compresses. The next level is low-level medicines, such as evening primrose oil and NSAIDs. The higher medical treatments use drugs like tamoxifen for estrogen blockade and danazol. Mondor's disease is superficial thrombophlebitis presenting as painful cords, with some skin redness usually in the lower outer breast and thorax. It can be caused by vigorous activity and sometimes after breast surgery. Treatment is with warm compresses and NSAIDs. There is no need for anticoagulation. Breast abscesses can initially be treated with antibiotics and maybe one attempt at aspiration only if they are small. But the multi-loculated nature of the abscesses means they commonly need incision and drainage. I recommend that most deep breast abscesses be drained in the OR, which allows the breaking up of the Cooper's ligaments and being sure the entire cavity is drained. Recurrent abscesses and fistulas of the breast may be a sign of granulomatous mastitis, which can sometimes require steroids to help this treatment. Puerperal abscesses is a fancy way of saying abscesses related to breastfeeding. Continue breastfeeding through treatment and be sure antibiotics are baby safe if you're going to do this. If a milk fistula persists after treatment for extended periods, then maybe stop breastfeeding. Most breast abscesses are staph organisms. You need to know the basic risks for breast cancer. Know the GAIL model that contains age, being older is worse, age at menses, being younger is worse, age at first live birth, having a first birth at a late age or being nulliparous is worse, having first degree relatives with breast cancer is worse, having a previous breast biopsy is worse, and certain races such as African American are higher risk. Higher risk patients may consider risk reduction with tamoxifen or prophylactic mastectomies or high risk screening such as alternating mammograms and breast MRI. Tamoxifen is used as chemoprophylaxis in women considering high risk for developing breast cancer. The 5-year GAIL model risk of over 1.67%, or if the patient has LCIS or atypical ductal hyperplasia or ADH, for example. This was shown in the NSABP P01 trial. Some women take hormone replacement therapy around menopause for vasomotor symptoms, which means hot flashes. The recommendation is to take HRT for less than 5 years, or this can lead to increased risk of breast cancer if taken longer than 5 years. Genetic testing is becoming a lot more common. Hard indications to do genetic testing would be breast cancer in a woman less than 50 years old, multiple first-degree relatives with breast cancer, males with breast cancer, and triple-negative breast cancer at any age, bilateral breast cancer, a family or personal history of pancreatic, ovarian, and breast cancers, and high-risk genetic groups such as Ashkenazi Jewish are tested more commonly. The most commonly asked about mutation is BRCA or BRCA, which is a tumor suppressor gene. BRCA1 is associated with a 55 to 65% chance of breast cancer and a 35 to 70% chance of ovarian cancer. BRCA2 is 45 to 55% chance of breast and 10 to 30% risk of ovarian. Either way, most BRCA 1 and 2 patients are recommended to have bilateral prophylactic mastectomies and prophylactic total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. There are some other high-risk genetic mutations for breast cancer coming up more commonly now, such as PALB2 and CHEK2. You'll certainly get a few of these in your career, and they'll continue to find more, I'm sure. Other genetic syndromes associated with breast cancer are Cowden syndrome, which is a P10 mutation associated with cancer of the breast, endometrium, kidney, and thyroid. Li-Fraumeni is a P53 mutation associated with breast, sarcoma, brain cancers, and adrenal cancer. Peutz-Jeghers is an STK11 gene mutation associated with perioral pigmentation, GI cancers, breast cancer, endometrium, and ovarian cancers. The general teaching is that the average woman has about a 7 to 12% lifetime risk of breast cancer, but if the lifetime risk is over 20%, prophylactic mastectomy may be a good idea. Next, let's talk about screening and imaging. I still think screening mammograms starting at 40 are a good idea. You can start screening mammograms 10 years younger than the age of a first-degree relative that has breast cancer. Screening MRI is appropriate starting in the mid-20s for high-risk family history or a known genetic mutation. Know the BIRAD system. BIRAD 0 means you need additional imaging immediately. BIRAD 1 is normal. BIRAD 2 is a benign finding and just do routine follow-up imaging. BIRAD 3 is a finding that is probably low risk for malignancy, but should have repeat imaging within 6 months to closely follow. BIRAD 4 means you should do a needle biopsy. BIRAD 5 means they are 95% sure it is cancer and definitely needs a biopsy. BIRAD 6 is a known cancer. Density is also usually reported on mammograms. It's read as A, which is not dense, mostly fat, through D, which are very dense breasts, usually in young or nulliparous women. Mammogram findings for DCIS is usually pleomorphic calcifications in a ductal branching pattern. Mammogram findings for invasive breast cancer is usually a spiculated mass. Ultrasound findings for DCIS are pretty minimal. Ultrasound findings for invasive cancer are a mass that is taller than wide, it has irregular margins, it invades tissue planes, it has posterior shadowing and high vascularity. The posterior shadowing with ultrasound is because breast cancer is super dense and absorbs the ultrasound beams, whereas cysts and fibroadenomas have posterior enhancement because the ultrasound beams travel easily through them. MRI is good at finding both invasive and in situ cancers. You will find a very wide variety of use of MRI among breast surgeons, but some basic rules are that MRI is good for high-risk screening and good to evaluate cancers in very dense breasts, possibly multifocal disease and in lobular cancers that are known to have a high risk of bilateral multifocal disease. MRI is always done with IV contrast. It is done in a prone position. I do not think FNA has much of a role in breast biopsy. I would always recommend a core needle biopsy of a breast lesion, and usually a radiologist uses a vacuum suction core needle biopsy to increase the tissue removed. A mammogram seeing calcifications usually gets a stereotactic biopsy, whereas masses seen on ultrasound usually get an ultrasound-guided biopsy. If neither of those is possible, there is such a thing as MRI-guided biopsy. Any biopsy should have a clip left in place to mark the location. The axillary nodes are usually screened with ultrasound in invasive breast cancer, and malignant characteristics of the nodes are a loss of a fatty hilum, a thickened cortex, and a round, not a kidney bean shape. You can also do ultrasound-guided biopsy of lymph nodes and leave a clip in those. Let's talk about findings on biopsy that need something done about them. If a core needle biopsy shows a radial scar or a complex sclerosing lesion, these can mimic breast cancer on mammogram appearance, and if found on needle biopsy, they should have a wire-localized excisional biopsy to ensure complete sampling. Core needle biopsy showing atypical hyperplasia, whether this is atypical ductal hyperplasia or atypical lobular hyperplasia, should go for a wire-localized excisional biopsy. The risk of finding something worse than the ADH or ALH is around 20%. If the margins have ADH or LAH, there is no need to resect more and there is no need to radiate. ADH and ALH increase the risk of future breast cancer 3 to 5 times higher than average. If core needle biopsy shows lobular carcinoma in situ, or LCIS, this is considered to be showing a high risk for future breast cancer in both breasts. It is not necessarily considered premalignant itself. If needle biopsy shows LCIS, then you should do a wire-localized excisional biopsy of the area. If all you find is LCIS, you don't need to resect more, even if the margins are positive for LCIS. The patient usually do not need radiation. Pleomorphic LCIS is a more aggressive variant that should be treated like DCIS, though. If a biopsy says something is benign or indeterminate, but the imaging is suspicious, such as a BIRADS 4 or 5, this could be called a discordant biopsy and should have an excisional biopsy done for more tissue. Fibroadenomas are common in young women and present with a mobile, rubbery mass. I resect benign fibroadenomas if over 3 centimeters in size or bothering the woman. If it is a young woman with a clinical fibroadenoma that is slowly growing and not large, doing a preoperative needle biopsy may not be needed. I would, however, definitely get a needle biopsy in large, rapidly growing masses because these could be a phyllodes tumor. Phyllodes are defined by having leafy, frond-like growth on microscopy, and they are on the spectrum between benign to borderline to malignant. The malignant variety is also called a cystosarcoma phyllodes. These have more mitoses, more cellular atypia, and more cellularity and stromal overgrowth. A borderline or malignant phyllodes should probably have a simple mastectomy done. If you find a smaller malignant phyllodes in a very large breast, you can consider wide excision with 1 to 2 centimeter margins. But the malignant ones tend to present as large, rapidly growing masses, so this is a relatively rare situation. A benign phyllodes can have a lumpectomy aiming for 1 to 2 centimeter margins. Lymph nodes do not need to be checked. Malignant phyllodes should have consideration for post-surgery radiation. Breast cysts present as painful, smooth, firm masses. They should generally not be biopsied if they look like simple cysts on imaging. Biopsy if it is a complex cyst in a postmenopausal woman associated with a mass or discordant with imaging. If none of these but the woman is symptomatic from this cyst, then it's okay to aspirate. If the aspiration is straw-colored fluid, do nothing. If the aspiration is bloody, then send cytology. If it's bloody fluid, also do a core needle biopsy of the cyst wall. Nipple discharge is common. Many women get green, brown, or milky fluid from the nipple, especially during the middle age years. This is not concerning. Pathologic nipple discharge tends to be bloody, unilateral, from a single duct, and occurring spontaneously. If it is concerning nipple discharge, obviously start with mammogram and ultrasound, looking for an intraductal papilloma, which is the most common cause of bloody nipple discharge. If a papilloma is seen, it is usually biopsied and a clip is left. I tend to do wire-localized excisional biopsies of papillomas still. If a woman has bloody nipple discharge and no cause is found on mammogram and ultrasound, then you can try a ductogram, but honestly they tend to be low yield and patients and radiologists hate doing them. The ductogram is trying to inject dye into a specific nipple duct to show a growth in it. If all imaging fails to show a cause for bloody nipple discharge, the last thing to do is just do a targeted duct excision in surgery. This is done by cannulating the duct with a tear duct probe or injecting methylene blue. These are ways of tracking the duct that needs to be excised. Sometimes this surgery is called a subareolar duct excision. Sometimes you can just try to remove a quarter of the nipple ducts, but don't remove all of them or you will cause an inverted nipple. Well, that's it for this portion. I hope that helped. See the next video for breast cancer and surgery discussions. Good luck.